Good morning, and welcome to Community Bible Church. We're so happy you decided to worship with us today. If you would, please stand. Join with myself and the choir as we sing, Lord, I Lift Your Name on High. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth. Lord, a hand of praise this morning. Amen.
I don't know why he thinks this isn't going to happen every year. You know, in the office last week, I thought, he's not mentioned his birthday. There's been not one word about birthday. So I guess he thought that I forgot it. Well, he should know better. So anyway, of course, we're here. We're going to recognize Brother Eddie. It's going to be short and simple. It won't hurt a bit. And as I'm sure you can see, that's what we're celebrating. Of course, his birthday is tomorrow. And he was born in 1959. This is his 65th birthday. So I pulled up some things from that era, and we will begin there. Y'all can sit down if you want to. So, first off, the average cost of a new house in 1959 was $14,000. A gallon of gas was 30 cents. A movie ticket was 68 cents. A postage stamp was 4 cents, and a whole loaf of bread was 20 cents. You could get a Volkswagen Beagle for $2,180, and you could make $5,000 a year if you were doing well. In office was our 34th U.S. President, Dwight D. Eisenhower. And this one's kind of, the U.S. population was 177 million. Today, it is 335 million. That's the U.S. The world population was 2.97 billion. It is now over 8.5 billion. To me, those were remarkable. The 50s slang. Okay, so when you said get bent, it meant go away. I didn't know that. go ape meant you were getting excited. This is pitiful. An ankle biter was a small child. Now, can you imagine? And a slodge was a friend. I had no idea. And if you were trendy back then, you would wear, as a man, a cardigan or a sweater. You'd have suit with the wingtip shoes and a fedora hat. And the women would wear petticoats. They'd have short bangs, pencil skirts, and a bouffant. And so, that's what you had. And so I was going to read. This is a poem that I found. So I wanted to read it, and it goes like this. Dust if you must, but wouldn't it be better to paint a picture or to write a letter? Bake a cake or plant a seed. Ponder the difference between want and need. Dust if you must, but there's not much time. With rivers to swim and mountains to climb, music to hear and books to read, friends to cherish and life to lead. Dust if you must, but the world's out there. With the sun in your eyes and the wind in your hair, a flutter of snow, a shower of rain, this day will not come around again. Dust if you must, but bear in mind, old age will come and it's not kind. And when you go and go you must, you yourself will make more dust. Well, you know I've got to say something funny all the time. But Brother Eddie, you know we love you. Your church family loves you. We love your family. We're thankful for you. We need you. And we admire your servant's heart. Happy birthday.
Now, hold on just a second. All right, so as customary, we're not going to get him away without doing this. We're going to sing Happy Birthday to Brother Eddie. Colin.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Brother Eddie. Happy birthday to you.
I'm done.
And it's also best birthday. And she's going to be 75, right? And Renee Flood's birthday. And thank you so much. You all have no idea how uncomfortable that type of stuff makes me feel. I really mean that. But thank you all so much. And thank you for recognizing me. I sort of feel like a little four-year-old who had gotten sunburned, and he was starting to peel. And as he was taking the skin off piece by piece, he said, "Here I am, 4 years old, and I'm coming apart already." You know, I sort of feel that way. But thank you, and I love you, and thank you so much for the sweet, kind words that you all have spoken already this morning. And as I've told folks, it sure gets here quicker than what you plan on it. But I'm so thankful to the Lord. Well, hey. The service would be about Jesus, okay? And so thank you so much. And we're so glad to have our guest today. And I'd like to ask our ushers to stand. And if you are our guest today, would you do us a wonderful favor by just raising your hand as they walk past you and take a card, fill it out, place it in the offering plate, and we would appreciate that greatly, okay? If you would do that. And thank you so much for being with us here at Community Bible Church. And let me share with you some announcements that you want to be mindful of. One is, this is the big week where our Valentine banquet is going to be Friday night. And as you've heard, Brother Greg Bowers is going to be sharing with us some of his favorite jokes. Liz Long is going to be sharing some music, and it's going to be a great time. It's going to be some door prizes you won't want to miss, great food. And so today is the last day to sign up. So if you would, be sure to do that. And that way we will know how much food to have. But it's going to be a great time. It's going to be at 6 o'clock Friday night. So be sure to be here with us and everything. And I know already many of you are already putting word out about Adam Crabb going to be with us on March the 3rd. And we're looking so forward to that. So many other things there. You can look in the bulletin and read. I don't want to spend a lot of time on all the announcements. But a lot of good things are taking place. You know, the greatest thing is, let's worship our Lord Jesus Christ today. Amen? And so let's just stand and let's worship him as Brother Jason comes and leads us. Okay? All right.
Round.
take our tithes and offerings. Join with us on Glorify Thy Name. Standing as Brother David Flood brings our offertory prayer this morning.
Good morning. I think I want to be there when he cuts that cake. Yeah, that's nice. Well, if you haven't, I know a lot of you weren't here this morning, but a lot of you were. We have some great Sunday school classes here, and I tell you, we've been very blessed with some great lessons here lately, and the fellowship that we share is just wonderful. So try to find one of us that teach or made it involved in one and holler at us. We'd like to get you set up in one. So let us pray. Dear Lord, we do thank you for another day, and we thank you for the beautiful days that you have given us this week, and we've seen your glory in them and your presence in them. Dear Lord, we do ask that we thank you for the lessons that we had in Sunday school today, and we ask now that you open our hearts and our minds to hear your message. And as always, please continue to bless Community Bible Church and help and lead and guide direct us, dear Lord. And as we go into this time of offertory, may we remember, reflect on how many riches and blessings that you give us and that we give in a way that is accordance to your worship and glorifies you, dear Lord. Be with us always and follow us in your word and forgive us when we fail you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Some are known by great authority, for kingdoms far as the eyes can see. In royal robes they rule from thrones, waging wars they overthrow the weak and call it victory. But my King is known by mercy, and my King is known by grace. For the hope in his name and a power that saves, my King is known by the cross, and my King is known by an empty grave. Oh, in all that he does, my King is known by love. Well, I can almost see him even now, rejected with thorns on his brow. What kind of king would leave his throne to make my sin and shame all his own? Yet he gave his life for me. He gave his life for me. My King is known by mercy, and my King is known by grace. For the hope in his name and the power that saves, my King is known by the cross, and my King is known by an empty grave. Oh, in all that he does, my King is known by a love that never welcomes everyone as his daughters and his sons. And no one is ever turned away. Oh, my King is known by mercy, and my King is known by grace. For the hope in his name and a power that saves, my King is known by the cross, and my King is known by an empty grave. Oh, in all that he does, my King is known by his amazing love. Amen.
Amen. I tell you what, those words, that'll put a glory bumps all over you. Amen. Thank you for the beautiful song there. Amen. Well, if you have your Bibles, I want to encourage you to turn to Luke chapter 23. Luke chapter 23. And I want to begin a new series of messages as we're moving toward Easter. Can you believe that Easter is just a few weeks away? And we're going to be looking at the last words that Jesus spoke from the cross. And, you know, you're probably very familiar with those words. But, boy, those words have so much to say to us. The last words from the cross. And if you would, in the honor of the reading of God's word, we want to look at a couple of verses here this morning in Luke chapter 23 and verse 33. And when they were come to the place, which is called Calvary, there they crucified him and the malefactors, one on the right hand and the other on the left. Then said Jesus, of all the words that he would pray and say, what would they be? Well, here they are. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And they parted his raiment and cast lots. Dear Lord, we want to thank you that you did not pray, Father, destroy them, or Father, annihilate them, but you prayed, Father, forgive them. Teach us, O God, your ways and your heart. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. As I said, we want to be looking at what we call the last words of Jesus from the cross. And you know, now we know all the words of Jesus that he ever spoke were so very important. But you know, when the Roman soldiers heard the words of Jesus, they came back and they reported to their superior. They said, no man has ever spoken like this man. And so his words, when he spoke, his words had authority. He could still the storm. He could raise the dead. He could cleanse the lepers. There was power in the words that Jesus spoke. And all the words were so important. But there's something about the words that he spoke from the cross. The words that Jesus spoke from the cross are of such vitally important. And you say, well, why is that so? Well, because they reveal the heart of God. I mean, if you want to know the heart of God, if you want to know the innermost being of God, then study the last words of Jesus from the cross. Now, last words are very important to us. Whenever a loved one is dying, and many of you, you've been there, and I've been there as a pastor, I've been there as with my own family members, and when you gather around the bedside and your loved one is about to pass, you listen very intently to their last words. It doesn't matter how faint their cry may be. It doesn't matter how they may stumble over their words. But you get down as close as you can and you listen to every last word that they say. Why? Because last words are important. I mean, when somebody's speaking their last words, they sort of weed through the unimportant stuff. I mean, they're not going to talk about the weather. They're not going to talk about ball scores. They're going to talk about that which is most dear to them. Last words. Last words are vital. Now, notice the background for the last words of Jesus. We see mankind at his worst. He was led out with the worst kind of people. The Bible says two thieves. He was led out to the worst kind of place, Calvary, which is interpreted the skull. He was led out to the worst with the worst kind of profanity, the words that the people yelled at him. And you find that he was led out to the worst kind of punishment. The Bible says there they crucified him. Crucifixion is that act of nailing a living victim to a cross. And that victim is already bleeding from the scourging that he has received. And the victim is hung there to die of hunger and thirst and exposure. And he can't defend himself. And just the torture of the gnats and the flies which would settle on his naked body and on his bleeding wounds. One Jewish writer said this. He said, crucifixion is the most terrible and cruel death which man has ever devised for taking vengeance on his fellow man. It was one of the worst forms of crucifixion or execution there. And though we see mankind at his worst, you see God at his best. And you see this in the first words that Jesus spoke from the cross. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. You know, forgiveness, the title of the message is the most needed word. I mean, when you think about words of the Bible, and so many of them are beautiful, the word grace, or the word love, the word salvation, the word come. Those are beautiful words, but it seems like forgiveness sort of is sort of like the colors of a rainbow, and the word forgiveness sort of includes all those attributes that I just shared. So there is Jesus. He's upon the cross, and he sees the people watching and laughing and sneering. He sees the soldiers gambling for his own clothes. And the very first thing that he says is, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Well, I want you to notice with me, I just want to point out a few things about these words. One is the surprising prayer. That's the prayer that he prays. He addresses the Father. Father. He addresses the Father. I mean, he could have focused on the injustices, the cruelty, the hostility, the suffering. But instead, he prays unto the Father. Why? Because he and the Father had such a close, intimate relationship. And so he focuses upon the Father. And it's a surprising prayer when you think about it. Because, you know, Calvary is not a place of prayer. It's a place of pain and suffering. Gethsemane was the place of prayer. Calvary is the place of agony. And we would expect that Jesus would call for Elijah to come with his chariots of fire and to take him away. Or perhaps he would call for Enoch to come and be translated from that cross, just like Enoch was translated when he walked with God. And so you find it surprising that he's not praying for deliverance. It's surprising that he's not asking God to send 10,000 angels to destroy the world and set him free. He doesn't pray for himself. He prays for others. Isn't that amazing? I mean, he prays not for his deliverance. He doesn't pray that the pain and suffering might be erased. He prays not like you and I probably would have prayed. He prays for those who put him upon the cross. His thoughts are not for himself, but his thoughts are for others. Now think of the pain that he has suffered. He's been flogged. He's been beaten. His beard has been plucked out by the hands of wicked men on his face. He's in his beard. He's got the nasty spittle of the Roman soldiers. He's been dragged from trial to trial. The false witnesses have lied against him. The Sanhedrin has called for his death, and he's been forced to carry his own cross for a while there. They nail his hands with nails through that wood, and they drive rust spikes through his feet. And after going through all of that, he prays a most beautiful prayer. It's a surprising prayer. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. You see, what a sensitivity he had to the needs that you and I have. I mean, he's so sensitive. You see, he knew the greatest need of those people around him and of those who put him on the cross was forgiveness. You see, the Bible says that Jesus said, he said, "I've come to seek and to save that which was lost." And so his prayer was consistent with his mission. You know, here he is. He breaks out in prayer. You know, it reminds us that you can talk to God anywhere, any place, about anything. Isn't that great to know? I mean, it doesn't matter where you might be, what you might be going through. The fact of the matter is, you can still pray to the Father. And so Jesus prays to the Father, and he's so sensitive to the Father. And though he's experiencing the rejection of men and the suffering and the pain and the anguish of Calvary, he's still praying and talking to his Father. You know, sometimes we might say, well, it doesn't do any good to pray. I mean, look what's happened to me. You know, look at the pain I'm in. Look how the world is treating me. What good does it do to pray to the Father and to follow the Lord? Well, Jesus did, and he was sensitive to the Father. So he prays this surprising prayer. He focuses upon the Father. So you see this surprising prayer. And then you see the needed pardon. He says, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." So he prays this prayer that they might experience this pardon within their life. You see, man had done his worst. the place where all the sins of the world were put on the Savior. You know, we sing that song, the place where years I spent in vanity and pride, knowing not that it was for me he died. And so his passion was that they would receive forgiveness. And that's the same passion that the Lord has for us, that we might receive the forgiveness of our sins, that we might receive the pardon for our sins. And so when Jesus prayed that prayer, he's offering the needed pardon that they had. And you find that there's a principle here in looking at this. You see, in the original language, the New Testament, most of it is written in common Greek language. And Jesus didn't just pray this prayer one time. He didn't just pray one time and say, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. No, the Greek indicates that it was a continuous action. It was over and over again. The words where he said and also the word forgive, both of those words are in the imperfect tense. In other words, it's like translating it like this. Jesus kept on saying and praying, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. I mean, he kept on praying, Father, forgive them. So when you see Jesus upon that cross and praying, Father, forgive them, you see, when they had the nails driven into his hands, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. When he was lifted up and that cross was dropped into that hole and his flesh was being ripped, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. When the insults were being hurled at him, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. When the soldiers were laughing and they were gambling with his clothes, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And over again, he was, and time, as he hung there upon that cross, he was praying, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. What a beautiful example. You see, the example that Jesus set for us is the fact that what he was practicing on Calvary is what he preached in the Sermon on the Mount. He was giving us an example to follow. Folks, it's hard to love your enemies, isn't it? It's hard to be good to those who hate you. It's hard to pray for those who talk about you. But when you come to Calvary, you listen to the first words of Jesus, and you catch the spirit of the one who is up on the cross. He never wronged anybody, and yet he forgave. Remember Stephen, the deacon, as he was being stoned to death? As he was dying, he looked up into heaven and said, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. Where did he learn that prayer? Remember the Apostle Paul as he spoke about those who had betrayed him and turned their back on him? And Paul said, Lord, do not charge them with this sin. Where did he learn that? From the cross. The example that Jesus set upon the cross. This example of learning how to forgive others. Because there are times people will wrong you. They will use you. They will lie about you. They will gossip about you. What do? You apply the principle of Calvary. The example that Jesus gave to pray that prayer, because he knew what they needed more than anything else was to be pardoned from their sins. Well, not only did he set the example in this prayer, but you see the extent of this prayer. You see, it was a pardon as he looked at those who were beneath the cross. The Roman soldiers who drove the nails into his hands, they needed forgiveness. The chief priests and scribes who cried for his death, they needed forgiveness. Judas, who had betrayed him, he needed forgiveness. Simon Peter, who had denied him, he needed forgiveness. And this was a prayer for them because they did not understand the impact of their crime. And Jesus is still praying for them. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And he took their judgment and our judgment there upon the cross. But not only was this a prayer, and not only did the extent of that prayer go for those who were beneath the cross, it was for those who were beyond the cross. those who would live in the centuries to come. In other words, all of us have had a part in putting Jesus on the cross. It was for our sins that he died. It was for our sins that he took our place. And so over 2,000 years ago, guess what he prayed for you? And guess what he prayed for me? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And he suffered for me. He suffered for you. He bled for you. He bled for me. He died for you. He died for me. And the extent of that prayer went beyond that day, and it went to each and every one of us. Why? Because what do we need? We need forgiveness for our sins. Because as the Bible says, we all have sinned and we come short of the glory of God. And when Jesus prayed, you know, there's a song, when he was on the cross, I was on his mind. And I was, because he was not only praying for those who were beneath him, but he was praying for those who were to still come. And the greatest need that we have is the need for forgiveness. Man, you may think you got a lot of needs in your life. Let me tell you, the greatest need you have is forgiveness from our Heavenly Father. Do you know that? And when he prayed, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do, because it was a needed pardon. And so you see that. And then you see, you know, in these words that he spoke, I think it reminds us of the unbelievable passion that he had. The unbelievable passion. I mean, when you see his heart, you see that Jesus was committed to the Father's will. Remember, he said, you know, my meat is to do the will of my Father, and while it is day, I must work before the night comes. And so he was committed to his Father's will, and nothing deterred him from doing his Father's will. And his will was to complete and pay the price for our sins so that we could be forgiven. So he continually prays, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And regardless of how bad it got for him, listen, he did not change course. He stayed committed to the will of his Heavenly Father. Why? Because he wants us to have forgiveness of our sins. And the very first priority, the very first thing he asked is, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Of all the things he could have prayed, he prayed, Father, forgive them. And that's why he was committed to the Father's will. And that's why the work that he did upon the cross is sufficient. Man, it was only that one sacrifice that is sufficient to receive the forgiveness of your sins. You see, if you add anything to salvation by grace through faith, if you add anything to that, that means what Jesus did upon the cross was not sufficient. Man, that's a serious doctrinal error. But what he did upon the cross, the work that he did upon the cross, is sufficient. And because of his work upon the cross, because of what he did, we can be forgiven of our sins, and we can be spared of the punishment that we so deserve. And so you see this passion that he had, that he was committed to the will of the Father, and you see the passion as he gave of himself upon the cross of Calvary. Many of you remember Paul Harvey, and boy, I miss Paul Harvey. He had such wisdom, and he could tell a story like no one else. But in one of his episodes, he tells the story of a man by the name of Carl Coleman. And Carl Coleman was driving to work one morning when he bumped fenders with another motorist. And both cars stopped, and the woman driving the other car got out to survey the damage. She was disturbed. She admitted that it was her fault, and hers was a new car. She had just gotten it 2 days before. And of course, she dreaded having to face her husband. And Coleman was sympathetic, but he had to pursue the exchange of license and registration. So she goes to the glove compartment, and there was a table that's a paper that sort of tumbled out. And it was written in her husband's handwriting there. And he had written these words. He said, in case of an accident, remember, honey, I love, it's you I love, not the car. When Jesus hung up on that cross, he was saying, it's you that I love. And therefore, he could pray those words, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And what you see up on that cross is a passion. It's you that I love. Regardless of how badly you've messed up, regardless of how terrible the circumstances may be, Jesus continues to pray, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He has such a passion for us to be forgiven. You see that passion when the prayer that he prayed was prayed? You see that passion in what the prayer asked for? Of all the things he could have asked for, he asked that we might be forgiven. And I don't know where you are today, but I just simply want to say, if you've never trusted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, his passion is that you might receive the forgiveness of your sins and that you might enter into a relationship with him. His passion is, his desire is forgiveness. You know, some people think, well, God's just up there and he just can't wait for us to mess up and he wants to punish us and he just wants to make our life miserable. His passion is that we might be forgiven of our sins. And this morning, I want to ask, if you've never asked the Lord to forgive you of your sins, man, he's willing to do it. I mean, the price has already been paid upon the cross of Calvary. The price has been paid. Why would you not receive that and receive him by faith into your heart as your Lord and Savior? And not only to enter into a relationship with him, but after we do that, and even when we sin as Christians, his passion is to forgive us of our sins. And he says, if any man confess his sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So he's, you know, he wants us to be in fellowship with him. And so when you see Jesus upon that cross and all the ugliness and the horror of what brought him to that place, I pray that you see that heart that he had as he looked down upon those folks and as he looks beyond time to us and hear that prayer, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And understand it's you and it's me. We are the ones that he loves. With our heads bowed and eyes closed this morning, Lord, we know that so many times in this old world and so many times the devil tries to convince people of things about you that are not true. And I pray that each of us today would see the truth of your word, that you have such a passion, such a desire that every person receive forgiveness for their sin. Father, I pray this morning that if there be one that has never asked you to forgive them, Lord, that even right now they would do that and place their faith and trust in you as the Lord and Savior of their life. God, may your will be done this service. We thank you that you were committed to your Father's will. And we thank you for what you did upon the cross is sufficient for us to be forgiven, because the shedding of your blood is the reason we have the forgiveness of our sin. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. And this morning,